Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Elizabeth Church. I'm the Vice President Academic here at Mount St. Vincent University, and I'm delighted to welcome you here for the first lecture in our series, Sex and the Citizen. You may wonder, it may seem a little strange that an institution that was founded by the Sisters of Charity should be hosting a series on sex, but when you think about what Mount St. Vincent represents, it actually makes a lot of sense. We were founded in 1873 as one of the few institutions for higher learning for women in the British Commonwealth. And we were actually the first institution, I think, in North America to award a BA to a woman. And we've persisted and maintained our focus on women's education and really a commitment to the exploration and understanding of issues to relate to women, gender, and sex. So it does make sense. This is the first time that we have partnered with CCEPA, and we're really happy to be doing that this year. And Chris will come up in a minute and say something about CCEPA. The current director is actually a former president of Mount St. Vincent, so that's another connection we have as well. This series started a couple of years ago. CCEPA's done a whole bunch of series on science and truth and science, and we thought, what about sex? We really need to be talking much more about sex. And so this series, the aim of this series is really, we'd like to stimulate debate about the ways that social policy and law really influence how we regulate and think about sex and sexualities, and also how our understanding and our social mores about sexuality are also playing into this. And I think I just want to mention two recent examples. One is, we were just talking about this before we came into the lecture, the recent decision in Ontario to strike down three things in the criminal just to do with prostitution and how that's really changing how we're talking and thinking about prostitution. Another one is the report that came out this week on the rates of teenage pregnancy in rural communities in Nova Scotia. And I don't know if you've been following the debate about that, but it's kind of, should we educate, should we regulate? So these are really issues that we're discussing all the time, so we're really hoping to by having these series, to raise the discussion and bring it out into the public. I'm going to ask Chris Stover, who's the general manager of CCEPA, to come up and say a few words about CCEPA first.
Good evening, everyone. As Elizabeth said, I'm Chris Stover, and I'm the general manager at the Canadian Centre for Ethics in Public Affairs, which is more commonly known as CCEPA. It's a joint initiative of the Atlantic School of Theology and St. Mary's University, and I'd like to welcome you here tonight and thank you for coming out on behalf of our board and our executive director, who you might know is Dr. Sheila Brown, who used to be the president here at the Mount. CCEPA provides an arena for critical thinking on policy discussion and research into current ethical challenges in our society. Ethics in public affairs is about how the values of individuals and organizations interact and evolve to enable us to live and work together more effectively. This is the first of a four-part series, which was co-created by CCEPA and a fantastic group of women here at Mount St. Vincent University. And we'll examine sex law, as Elizabeth said, sex education, the sex trade, and sex in public policy. And we begin here tonight with Reinventing the Sexual Contract, dealing with ethical questions about sex, marriage, and autonomy. We'll be back here again in January with Sex Goes to Market. That's Melissa Ditmore, editor of the Encyclopedia of Prostitution and Sex Work, and chair of the advisory board of the Sex Workers Project. In February, Dr. Gary Kinsman from the Department of Sociology at Laurentian University in Sudbury, Ontario, will deliver part three on the sexual citizen. And we'll wrap up the series back here again in March with Sex at School, featuring Judith Levine, who's author of Harmful to Minors, The Perils of Protecting Children from Sex. All these events will be presented right here, and we're also hoping to live stream. So if you can't make any of those events, check out the websites, both the Mount and CCEPA, and you can find out how to get more information on how to watch or see the video once it's posted online. Before I go, there are evaluation sheets in front of you. We'd really appreciate it, both the Mount and CCEPA, as we move forward with this series to find out what you liked, what you didn't like, and how you feel about what we've done here tonight. So I'll leave you to it. Thank you.
And it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker for tonight, Dr. Laurie Shrage. I should say the reason we have Dr. Shrage here tonight is because of her interest in Cape Breton fiddle music. She's actually heading tomorrow to give a talk at Cape Breton, and they promised if she came, they would take her to a concert. And we managed to snag her on the way to Cape Breton, so we really feel very fortunate to have her here this evening. Dr. Shrage is going to be talking about reinventing the sexual contract, ethical questions about sex, marriage, and autonomy. She is the director of the Women's Studies Program at Florida International University in Miami and a professor in the Department of Philosophy. Professor Shrage is a well-known feminist philosopher. In much of her work, she's considered questions about how we can develop good social policies in relation to issues that often spark strong and divisive views. She's written on prostitution, adultery, abortion, and sex assignment, reassignment. And she's particularly focused on laws and regulations that pertain to women, gender, and sexual dissidents. Tonight, she will be proposing a provocative idea that we should consider developing a legal contract for sexual partners that would spell out one's rights and responsibilities in a sexual relationship, just as rights and responsibilities are defined in other relationships. After Dr. Shrage speaks, we're very fortunate to have our discussant, Dr. Elaine Craig, who's an assistant professor at the Schulich School of Law at Dalhousie University, from which she received her PhD. And prior to that, she was a Trudeau scholar for 3 years. She did her master's at Yale and her law degree at Dalhousie. And she'll be responding to Dr. Shrage. She's published articles on sexual assault, the criminal regulation of sex work, feminist legal theory, and her specialty is queer legal theory. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Shrage.
Anyway, it's delightful to be here, coming from Miami in your exotic climate here, and very different sort of colors and temperature. I really want to thank the organizers of this series with this wonderful title, and it's great to be part of it, and my hosts. It's been great to meet everybody here. This may also be a good moment. I was reading, was it yesterday or today in the New York Times, that the Vatican and the Pope are weakening their position against condom use. So I thought that was promising in many ways. So clearly there are lots of debates that are going on about sexuality. As your vice president mentioned, this talk, I make a proposal that I've been thinking about for a while and never really developed because it just seemed too sort of preposterous. And often papers start with that, but the more I thought about it and the more I worked out the ideas, the more convinced that I became anyway, I don't know that I'll convince anyone else, but the more convinced I became that this was the right way to deal with a host of issues that figure into lots of debates about sexuality and particularly sexuality and marriage. And so I'll try to today make that coherent. I have to say, when I was writing this paper, I wasn't necessarily thinking of a Canadian audience, as Americans often don't think internationally. So it'll be particularly interesting to me to hear whether these ideas make a lot of sense in a Canadian context. One of the main differences, although there are lots of similarities between Canada and the United States, and you'll see how that's relevant to my talk, is that you have same-sex marriage is legal here, whereas in the U.S. we're still having a big debate about it, and it's only legal in a few states. So I think I'm going to do, since I don't have to use this mic, is maybe stand to the side of my slides and then come over. But I start with, let's see if this will work, my little... In this book, which I was reading this summer, Love and Sex with Robots, the artificial intelligence expert David Levy makes a surprisingly convincing case that in the not too distant future, some percentage of people will have fulfilling relationships with robots. His prediction is based on several factors: that artificially intelligent and sexually competent robots will soon be available, that research on what people are seeking in a sexual partner suggests that robotic partners will soon be able to compete with most humans, and that sexual relations with robots have a number of advantages over those with humans. Some of you who are familiar with AI may have some idea of what some of those advantages may be, but some advantages include physical attractiveness, although the reviewers of this robot, I guess, didn't think so. Ability to be programmed, to be attentive, neat, funny, or in possession of whatever personality traits one desires. 24/7 availability for companionship and sex. Reduced risks of STIs, pregnancy, sexual cheating, and sexual rejection. The ability to have an emotionally uncomplicated sexual relationship, or if one desires a sexual relationship that is at least as emotionally complicated as with one's pet. And because robots can attain a degree and a level of intelligence that's pretty much like a dog. And I think the assumption is that people will anthropomorphize their robots in the same way we anthropomorphize our dogs. And then the last advantage, and there are many more, but the last one I'll note is that robots would have the technologically enhanced sexual capabilities that are equal to that of the best available sex toys. But I'm not going to go into all that technology tonight. There's an area of sexual technology called teledildonics, which you can Google and find out more about it. As the image on the cover of Levy's book suggests, he also forecasts that the next frontier for marriage reform will focus on human-robot marriage. It was at this point in reading Levy's book that I began to have some doubts. Now, some of you might have had doubts earlier, but I was taken with his argument and convinced. But so I asked myself, why would one want to or need to marry one's robot? If part of the purpose of marriage, right, is to acquire a devoted romantic and sexual partner who can be domesticated and altered to the degree necessary for a comfortable personal and home life, and to establish an emotionally uncomplicated relationship at some point, you know, after 10 years or so, or that is to get off the emotional roller coaster of dating and rotating partners, while hopefully minimizing the risks of an STI, an inconvenient pregnancy, and disloyalty, then it would seem that taking robots as lovers accomplishes many of the goals of marriage without having to legally tie the knot, so to speak. That is, marriage to a robot would seem unnecessary, as one would have solved the problems of the single life with technology rather than a legal contract, right? It's just a different approach to the same set of problems. Of course, some people will want to marry their robot lovers to make a public statement about the importance of their relationship, but I somehow, and this is where my doubt came in, I somehow doubt that there will be a movement of human-robot couples pressing for access to marriage in the future. However, at least in the US, what human-robot couples will have to challenge, at least, are laws that impede the purchase of one's partner. That is, insofar as a robot might count as a sex toy. And this is perhaps a sort of backward conception of what these beings are. But at the moment, a robot is something like a fancy sex toy, or some robots, I should say. In other words, human-robot couples presently face the legal hurdles that same-sex couples faced before anti-sodomy laws were struck down in all 50 states by our Supreme Court. Oops. What is this little thing in the middle here? Let's see if I can get rid of it. Okay. So I start with this example because I'm interested in investigating the social compulsion to place relationships that are sexual within marriage, even sexual relationships with machines. So that was the point of this extended example with robots. Even relationships with robots are imagined to be somehow moving toward access to marriage, as if this were the ideal for all relationships. Although in secular liberal democratic countries, tolerance for premarital and extramarital sex has increased, we still categorize sex in terms of whether it is marital or non-marital. That is, while premarital and extramarital sex are no longer illicit or illegal in most contexts, sex in marriage is still regarded as the most licit and permissible form of sex and is perhaps even obligatory, as this cartoon suggests. That is, the idea that marital couples should maintain sexual intimacy is a kind of modern concept and actually is sort of a break from the past. While the notion that sexual couples should be married is a more traditional concept and perhaps is changing. The favorable status of marital sex is partly why debates over access to marriage are so heated. Whoever gains access to marriage will find their sexual relationship socially valued and positively sanctioned. While sexual relationships outside of marriage are no longer negatively sanctioned as severely as they once were, they are just simply merely tolerated. Now, there are good reasons to view marriage as advantageous for people in a sexual relationship. Marriage provides certain social safeguards that mitigate the consequences and injuries of sexual relationships. Sexual acts involve removing and crossing social boundaries, social and physical boundaries that are required in ordinary interaction. Because of this, sexual partners place themselves in a highly vulnerable state. Such encounters can result in the loss of bodily and mental integrity, for example, by transmitting an illness or causing an unwanted pregnancy or precipitating emotional and social trauma. In marriage, sexual couples are bound to provide economic, social, emotional, and other forms of support for each other that enable individuals to cope with the consequences of their sexual intimacy. Marriage also defines the terms for dissolving sexually intimate relationships so that each party can be left with as much economic, emotional, and physical wholeness as possible. In this talk, however, I want to question whether marriage is the most desirable way to promote the social safeguards for those who are sexually intimate. There are many people who desire to have sexual relationships without cohabitating or co-parenting with their sexual partners and without making a commitment to sustain a relationship until the death of one's partner or the death of one of the partners. The prevalence of non-marital sex, both presently and historically in many societies, I think reflects such desires. If we think it's okay and we genuinely approve of such sex, shouldn't we want to create the social and legal conditions that would encourage non-marital sexual partners to protect themselves and behave responsibly toward one another? My project is to explore what these social and legal conditions might be, and in particular to explore the idea of a sexual contract. So this cartoon, I'm sort of seriously proposing this. I don't think it would be called a fornication contract or license, but we might call them a love contract, or that might, if anybody comes up with a better name, please tell me. But my project is to explore the idea of a sexual contract that would allow sexual partners to define the terms of their relationship and create social safeguards in order to enable unmarried sexual partners to protect each other's interests and well-being. But before I develop my proposal, I will briefly review why sex outside of marriage is viewed either as a phenomenon that requires significant social intervention of a preventative sort, or as a phenomenon that needs no social intervention at all, right? So the difference between conservatives and liberals regarding sex outside of marriage. Social conservatives generally hold that marriage is a precondition for respectful, responsible, and moral sex. Sex outside of marriage is sometimes regarded as a misuse of our sexual capacities and is alleged to cause many social problems, such as teenage pregnancy, neglected children, poverty, the spread of STIs. Historically, women having sex outside of marriage has been viewed as especially problematic due to double standards of sexual morality. Women in conservative families and cultures are regularly counseled by parents and others not to permit a man to use them in a sexual way without demonstrating good intentions, and generally that meant by committing to marriage. In the U.S., conservative groups have promoted abstinence-only sex education and chastity pledges to discourage non-married teenagers and young adults in their 20s, mostly, from having sex. Virginity is touted as a critical asset, especially for girls, that one contributes to a future marriage, as in this example of such a pledge. Now, for probably somewhat obvious reasons, many feminists have challenged the sexist thinking behind the valorization of female virginity and chastity, and the idea that non-marital sex is bad for women. The male preference for virgins that we see in a number of countries implies that sex is more degrading to women than it is to men, and that a sexually experienced woman is somehow damaged. Feminists have also, some of you may recognize this poster. The artist here is Barbara Kruger. And it's actually was a poster from the pro-choice campaigns, but also a poster generally promoting control, the control over one's own body for women. So feminists have also challenged the idea that women ought to yield to sex with men only to obtain non-sexual ends, such as economic security or children expected in a marriage. Some feminist theorists contend that women, like men, should pursue sex primarily for its unique pleasures and enjoyments. If women pursue sex for the same reasons men do, in a way regarded as more congruent with the unique and organic benefits of sex, they are less likely to be viewed as debasing themselves in the pursuit of ulterior ends. In other words, if women seek and gain sexual pleasure from sex, this was a kind of, some of you may not remember a time when that was questioned, whether women get pleasure from sex or even had orgasm. But if women were seeking sex for the same reasons as men, then like men, they could be represented as agents who act somewhat rationally and selfishly in pursuing sex rather than as mere victims of others' sexual compulsions. Of course, for women to avoid mercenary sex, they must have some form of economic independence from men, which of course feminists strongly endorse. The upshot, though, and I think this is the point that's been missed, is that the less that sex degrades women morally or socially, the less women need marriage to mitigate what conservatives would conceptualize as their sexual corruption. Right? If sex doesn't corrupt and damage women, sex outside of marriage, then they don't need marriage to protect them from that form of corruption. For these reasons, few feminist thinkers are socially conservative when it comes to sex and marriage, Sarah Palin notwithstanding. Many of you know, she calls herself a feminist. And I think she can claim that label, and I have no objection to her claiming it. Marriage is neither necessary or sufficient for non-degrading sex, for surely marital partners can sexually exploit, manipulate, and abuse each other. And I think many feminists show that in marriage and outside of marriage, women can be sexually exploited. Although marriage has undergone much legal reform in the last century, so that in the US, for example, wives and husbands have essentially the same legal rights and responsibilities, the sexist and heterosexist reality or social reality of marriage in many cases still renders it, at least for feminists of my generation, a somewhat suspect institution. For this reason, few feminists would regard the marital status of sexual partners as relevant to the moral appraisal of a sexual relationship. Instead, it has become somewhat standard among social and political liberals, including many feminists, to regard mere consent among all adult participants as the only condition necessary for moral sex. Consent should be given, of course, voluntarily, but liberals disagree on how informed, ideally, it should be. For example, liberals disagree on whether sexual partners must disclose their health status, marital status, sexual history, born sex, use of birth control, fetish practices, and sexual fantasies. Some argue that individuals are each responsible for protecting themselves against disease and pregnancy and can use their own judgment about how much information to give or get about a partner's other sexual relationships, past or present, or about their partner's sexual interests, gender identity, and so on. Some of you are philosophers will be familiar with this book and the work of Martha Nussbaum, and I think she's kind of indicative of the view of a different approach by feminist philosophers who have argued that moral sex requires more than just mere consent, even when reasonably informed and fully voluntary. Consent, even informed consent, is too minimal a condition for moral sex. Moral sex also requires treating a sexual partner as an autonomous and an irreplaceable human agent. That is, moral sex requires avoiding objectifying and manipulative, instrumental, or harmful treatment, even when one's partner consents to such treatment. Many feminist theorists have sought to identify and critique both marital and non-marital sexual practices that are inconsistent with respectful treatment of women as autonomous human agents. And some of these practices feminists have critiqued, including myself and others in this audience, are the practices of prostitution, pornography, date rape, marital rape, sexual harassment, restrictions on contraception, right, and so on, which restrict, again, women's autonomy in sex. Some women want to separate reproduction from sex and therefore want to be able to use contraception. Now, it's not clear to me, however, that respect for sexual autonomy in men can be accomplished simply by discouraging or prohibiting particular practices and behaviors. That is, the approach so far by a lot of feminists is to identify those sexual practices that are seen not to fulfill this sort of higher standard of respect for autonomy, and just simply think about ways of restricting those practices. One of the purposes of marriage is to define the legal rights and responsibilities of sexual partners in regard to their sexual conduct and its consequences, such as childbearing would be an example. Given the emotional and physical and economic and social risks of sexual intimacy, as I mentioned earlier, establishing the parameters of such relationships can be advantageous for both parties. Typically, marital partners are expected to provide sexual comfort for each other and generally no one else. They're expected to support children resulting from their union and to support each other emotionally and economically in times of good health and bad. Marital partners have hospital and prison visitation rights and can share in their partner's employment and social benefits, such as health insurance, pensions, and residence rights. Moreover, legal marriage defines the terms of separation should a couple decide to dissolve their union, as this cartoon suggests. In other words, marriage offers individuals the opportunity to sacrifice some freedoms in order to gain particular rights and privileges. Importantly, the opportunity to participate in this social institution augments our capacity for self-determination or autonomy, at least for those who desire the particular package of entitlements and duties that legal marriage offers. For those who want this package, they are offered a basic mechanism for defining their family associates and for building economic and personal security and for distributing financial assets and children upon separation. In short, this mechanism provides a significant avenue for structuring and enhancing our adult lives and protecting the well-being of our children. So it works for some, and I'm not here to say we should entirely get rid of marriage or traditional marriage. But outside of marriage, the terms of sexual relationships are informal and undefined. although unmarried sexual partners are no longer criminals, and their children are no longer illegitimate in many countries, not all, and this would be an example of one where it's still criminal, there are few laws that define the rights and responsibilities of unmarried sexual partners. Some countries have laws against negligence or maliciousness in the transmission of a disease, which can protect both marital and unmarried partners. And lovers of rich people have managed, in some cases, to get palimony awards upon separation. This may just be in the United States. I don't know if this has happened in Canada. But you have to be, you know, have a wealthy sex partner to get that kind of award. But in general, while tolerance for sex outside of marriage has increased, there has been little effort to define and codify the expectations, privileges, and responsibilities in these non-marital sexual relationships. Except, of course, when they are still criminal. And then it's clear what their status is. Of course, some people may think this is as it should be. That is, outside of marriage, anything goes, a la Cole Porter, and society should take a laissez-faire approach to non-marital sexual relationships. Some may feel that people should be free to have sex outside of marriage, but they should then assume whatever risks are involved, emotional, medical, social, or financial. But such attitudes, to me, suggest that there's still a residual moral disapproval of non-marital sex, right? By not providing a mechanism for people outside of marriage to formalize the terms of their sexual relationship in ways that protect whatever interests they feel might need protection, we diminish their capacity for self-determination. And I'm using sort of that term interchangeably with the idea of autonomy. Why should there be only two alternatives, a formal contract for sexual partners who want to cohabitate indefinitely, co-parent, co-own property, and basically commingle all aspects of their lives, and who often typically then want exclusive sexual rights to each other, and an undefined social and legal relationship for sexual partners who do not want to cohabitate, et cetera, but nevertheless want to establish some parameters and expectations? So right now we have sort of two choices, marriage and non-marriage, or marital sex and non-marital sex. So there happen, though, to be societies that do provide institutional options for people who are sexual partners, but who are not candidates for marriage, either by their own choice or by that of others. For example, the Iranian or Islamic practice of sihe, or sometimes called muta, in other Islamic societies, and is sometimes, although I'm not sure that this is the best translation, but it's often translated as temporary marriage, sihe offers a religiously sanctioned contract of fixed duration, it can be from several minutes to 99 years, to sexual couples who often do not cohabitate, unlike in a civil union or domestic partnership. According to Shalah Hariri in her 1989 book on this practice, and I quote, before the revolution of 1979, the secular Iranian middle classes dismissed temporary marriage as a form of prostitution that had been legitimized by the religious establishment. Hariri argues for a more nuanced understanding of this practice, which has a long history. She writes, and I quote again, sometimes the institution has been dismissed by the state as archaic, a remnant of backwardness no longer suitable for a modern state poised on the brink of development and progress. At other times, it is advanced by the religious establishment as one of the most brilliant laws of Islam, devised for the welfare of human beings and their society. And this, again, is still a quote by Hariri. Sometimes it is used by women as a means of asserting autonomy and exerting some degree of control over their lives. At other times, they are abused in the same set of laws. Sometimes temporary marriage is used to reinforce the structure of sex segregation, and at other times as a means of subverting it. The practice of sihe recognizes that there are basically three alternatives: abstention from sex outside of marriage, engaging in illicit sex outside of marriage, or providing for illicit sex outside of marriage. Given that abstention is unlikely for most people, the practice attempts to carve out some social space for illicit premarital and extramarital sex. As Hariri points out, the practice can offer some social protection for women who have sex with men outside of marriage, but it can also be a bad bargain if it renders them unmarriageable in a society that requires virginity upon marriage and in which a woman's status and well-being are highly dependent on eventually entering a conventional marriage. Elaine Ciolino, the New York Times reporter, writing in 2000, claims that, quote, an odd mix of feminist clerics and officials have begun to discuss CCEPA as a possible solution to the problems of Iran's youth. An extraordinarily large number of young people, about 65% of the population, is under 25 in Iran, combined with high unemployment, means that more couples are putting off marriage because they cannot afford it. CCEPA, and this is still Ciolino's point, CCEPA legally wraps premarital sex in an Islamic cloak. Ciolino summarizes her interview with a feminist Iranian journalist, Shala Sherkat, who's editor of a feminist monthly called Zanan, and she interviewed this editor about the practice of CCEPA, and according to Sherkat, quote, and Sherkat defends the practice in the following way. She says, first, sexual relations between young men and women will become a little freer. Second, they can satisfy their sexual needs. Third, sex will become depoliticized. Fourth, they will use up some of the energy they are putting into street demonstrations. And finally, our society's obsession with virginity will disappear. And that's a quote from Sherkat. Ciolino also notes that advocates of temporary marriage point out that children of such unions are legitimate and entitled to a share of their father's inheritance. So this is a kind of reevaluation of this practice, and I want to go over these reasons a little bit more carefully. Actually, the only reason here I have trouble with is number four, because I don't think the conditions for legitimate political protest should be undermined. And because I don't think the practice of CCEPA also is likely to do this unless the recent political protests in Iran can be attributed to repressed sexual energy, which I don't think is what, you know, is the cause of them. So let me comment on the validity of the other points that she makes. Point number one, it seems to me in a society in which men and women are segregated, often socially segregated, due to fears of illicit sex, having the opportunity to make sexual relations short of full-scale marriage licit may ease restrictions on interactions between men and women. Easing such restrictions should enable women to move more freely in male-dominated public spaces of politics and employment, and I think this is something feminists should support. So I agree with Sherkat in that reason for reevaluating CCEPA. The second point, allowing young people to satisfy their sexual needs without risking severe social punishment, you know, also seems like a very good idea. And if there is a practice that will allow that, that's good. Her third point, that it will depoliticize sex in the sense of, and I think here she means in the sense of diffusing fear of its socially destructive force, which can then be used or invoked in favor of greater political and social restrictions, that also seems worthwhile if in fact bringing back the practice of CCEPA will do this. So it would be, can be used less by the religious leaders, you know, the fears about non-marital sex could be used less by religious leaders to justify greater repression. Her fifth reason, any practice that would challenge obsessions with female virginity or at least initiate broad public conversation about it as a requirement for marriage, to me, is most definitely a good thing. So, and I think to a lot of feminists. And then her point number six, recognizing the children of such unions as legitimate and entitled to a father's support seems to me also desirable. And CCEPA could minimize the need for costly paternity lawsuits. So even where, in some cases, the children outside of marriage are recognized as legitimate, sometimes it requires, you know, expensive lawsuits. While CCEPA might be a good practice to support in a conservative theocratic society, is it really a good thing in a liberal secular state? Right. So that's the question. This may be like asking the question, you know, why pay for anything when you can get it for free? which reflecting somewhat sexist values is a question men often ask with respect to sex and marriage, right, as this suggests. But why intermarriage or a sihe agreement when sex is readily available without it in liberal secular societies? This is where my project gets, perhaps is a little controversial, because I want to argue that just as marriage has a place in liberal secular societies, so does a practice like sihe. Of course, both practices need to be modified to fit the values of liberal secular societies and democracies. For example, one obvious modification is that no religious group could maintain authority over its practice, purpose, or terms. It could not, for example, in a liberal secular society, be wrapped in an Islamic cloak or a Christian or a Jewish one. So imagine lovers who do not choose to live together, have children, or make a commitment to each other for life, perhaps due to unemployment, stage of life, or commitments they have to others, but who wish to formalize other aspects of their relationship. For instance, they may wish to make socially binding the nature and amount of material support that each will provide during or upon the dissolution of their relationship. They may wish to formalize visitation rights in the case of hospitalization. They may wish to also formalize rights of inheritance in the case of one's partner's death, or the responsibilities of each in the case of an accidental pregnancy or STI. Why leave it to the courts to sort these things out in the event that their relationship turns adversarial if sexual partners can come to some agreement in advance about their duties and entitlements in their relationship? The availability of something like a sihe contract would encourage those who are sexually intimate but not good candidates for marriage to consider and discuss the parameters of their relationship in ways that would maximize respect for each other's autonomy. Perhaps there should be a standard contract form itemizing the kinds of entitlements and expectations that lovers often wish to formalize so that sexual partners could simply check off those that apply to them. And then an inexpensive contract registration or filing procedure with the appropriate public authorities. Of course, no one would be forced to enter such contractual agreements, but their availability would create opportunities for some to build safeguards into their sexual relationships and thereby maximize opportunities that adults would have for enriching sexual relationships while providing, while protecting their interests and those of their loved ones. Some members of the GLBT community have criticized, this is in the United States, and I don't know if this this happened in Canada, but in the US, there's a growingly vocal portion of the GLBT community, the gay and lesbian community, that has criticized the priority that their movement has given to gaining access to marriage. Some activists see long-term monogamous marriage as a problematic institution designed primarily to fit the lifestyles of heterosexual couples. In an interview with NPR, Matilda Sycamore, who's the editor of this book, states, quote, "Very few people actually conform to this notion of what marriage is supposed to be. I mean, the last time I checked, marriage was a failing institution. And why are gay people now propping up this failed institution instead of creating more opportunities for everyone?" End quote. Sycamore argues that the push for gay marriage is a form of, quote, cultural erasure, in which the benefits of full citizenship are offered only at the price of social conformity. She states, quote, "I think if someone wants to have a long-term monogamous coupled partnership that is loving and caring, that's wonderful. The problem for me with the gay marriage movement is it actually limits people's options rather than increasing them." End quote. Sycamore suggests that the GLBT community includes and endorses a diversity of sexual lifestyles and family configurations, and should be working to ensure that those who do not conform to long-term monogamy have access to health benefits, fair and reasonable custody arrangements with children, rights of inheritance and visitation, tax benefits, and so on. A person should not have to conform to the ideals of traditional marriage in order to gain social benefits and protections that enable them to support their non-traditional families and love relationships. As I've alluded to earlier, feminists too have critiqued the institution of long-term monogamy as a trap for women. Laura Kipnis describes marriage as a, in this work some of you may be familiar with, she describes marriage as a domestic gulag in which sexual freedom is sacrificed to the misguided imperatives of capitalist society. Marriage traps women and also men in unhappy relationships as well as jobs required to support these relationships. Kipnis does not elaborate much of an alternative to marriage in that her ultimate aim is basically to question the romantic ideal of long-term monogamy that especially girls and women buy into, whether it's formalized or not. But I think what is needed, or that's what I want to contend, what's needed is social respect and support for different kinds of sexual lifestyles and family relationships that are mutually supportive and enriching, including those in which reproduction or maintaining a common household are not the main focus. So my proposal is to create sexual contracts similar in some ways to the practice of sihe or muta. Combines the insights and creativity of the GLBT community regarding diverse sexual expression with feminist insights that sexual partners should respect each other's autonomy and non-fungible or non-replaceable, respect each other as autonomous and non-fungible, non-replaceable human agents. Sex contracts or love contracts, whatever they're called, provide a mechanism for non-monogamous and non-long-term monogamous lovers to gain some level of social recognition and respect for their non-traditional sexual relationships and family arrangements, as well as some practical benefits such as greater control about how they want to share their property or the custody of their children, if they have them, and so on. This is my last slide, so we'll get to the comments soon and hear a reaction to this rather perhaps crazy idea, but we'll see. There are many questions, I think, about sexual contracts that I haven't answered, such as how many such contracts a person should be permitted to secure simultaneously, how flexible their terms should be, and how they would be enforced. And I'm going to take a very quick stab at these obvious questions and then end, and I'm sure there are many other things that I haven't thought of. So in the interest of supporting diverse sexual relationships that are enriching and sustaining of one's physical and emotional health, I would recommend that multiple contracts should be acceptable to serve the needs, for example, of the polyamorous, and that the terms of these contracts should be as flexible as possible, given that the normative ideals about relationships they reflect are minimal but substantive. Substantive in that the main ideal here would be respect for each other's autonomy. And also, obviously, with sihe, as it is practiced in Islamic societies, married women are not allowed to enter these contracts, but married men are, which is obviously not something I would endorse. Whether people who are married in a traditional way should be allowed to enter these contracts is obviously something open for debate. But I would argue, obviously, if married men are able to enter these kind of contracts, and so should obviously married women. How much there would have to be a kind of disclosure before you could enter another one to new partners is another issue that we should ask about. Regarding enforcement, I would expect that they could be enforced much like a marriage contract, in that either party could have recourse to a judicial process or a professional mediation in the event that one party felt there was a breach of contract and wanted to end it unilaterally. And of course, if there was agreement about ending it, then it could be, like we have no-fault divorce. The basic idea here is to balance our interest in supporting sexual diversity while at the same time recognizing that people make emotional and financial investments in sexual relationships that can give rise to expectations and entitlements they would like to formalize. Institutionalizing a practice like suhe in secular democratic societies provides a concrete mechanism for doing this, in sort of the same way marriage, right, provides a mechanism for doing this. In her book, The Sexual Contract, Carol Pateman, a political scientist, argues that the social contract of liberal theory implicitly contains a sexual contract that defines the terms under which men are granted access to women. Institutions such as marriage and prostitution define the rules for this, for example, by determining which women will become wives or prostitutes and what forms of sexual access men will have in relation to women of different categories and social statuses. Pateman demonstrates that the implicit sexual contract of many contemporary liberal societies incorporates many of the principles of patriarchal, illiberal, and authoritarian societies. Like many feminists, she argues for banning prostitution and for the radical reform of marriage rights. But rather than banning prostitution, or creating greater restrictions on sexual practices that we think are based on patriarchal assumptions, and rather than reforming marriage to fit every sexual and familial lifestyle, my approach is to create new social contexts for sex. These contexts would transform potentially objectifying, instrumental, and exploitative sexual practices into ones that are consistent with respect for others as autonomous human agents. I actually believe this is possible in sexual relationships in which there are unidirectional exchanges of money, or those that are also those that are more egalitarian economically. And as I'm saying, I think this is possible also in relationships that involve something we might call paid sex. And I think this is also possible, that is, you know, mutually respectful sexual relationships in those that are short-term as well as those that are long-term. So my proposal, stated in the language of political liberal theory, is to build institutions that take sexual intimacy outside of a state of nature and incorporate it into civil society in ways that reflect the anti-patriarchal and anti-heterosexist values of the feminist and GLBT community. Some may find it odd that my model for this suhe is an institution that comes out of authoritarian patriarchal societies, but so does marriage and prostitution if we look back far enough historically, right? Marriage comes out of more traditional patriarchal societies. A new kind of sexual contract other than those of traditional marriage or the basic market exchange, so marriage or prostitution. It seems to me that having something, an alternative to those, right, would offer a concrete vehicle for creating a new kind of civil order. And so essentially my approach is to take a positive step in offering a mechanism for more respectful sexual relationships outside of marriage, as opposed to negatively trying to restrain or critique sexual practices that fall outside of marriage, such as those involved in paid sex. So anyway, I'll end here and hear what your reaction is. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to serve as the discussant. I've never been a discussant before. I didn't even really know what that meant, actually. And thank you so much, Dr. Shrage, for your very thought-provoking presentation, and one which I'm sure will engender further discussion among all of us. I won't take up too much time. But rather, I'll just offer a few comments which respond to some of Dr. Shrage's insights, but from a Canadian perspective, and primarily from a Canadian legal, constitutional law perspective. What's so interesting about this discussion is, like so often when we compare legal approaches to social issues in Canada and the United States, or in any two countries or jurisdictions, it reveals a very different, I think, legal culture with respect to, you know, the relationship between individuals and the state, for one thing, or perhaps more specifically, the role of the state and our notion of what constitutes shared interests and public issues and what ought to be understood more as private issues. So I think, one of the things that I thought about when I was reading your paper was in the Canadian context, there's a history of, I'd say there's both a history of and a contemporary level of comfort with allowing or even promoting the state to respond to, a comfort with public law involvement regarding even issues like sexual ethics. So one of the points that you made was that in the American context, the law tends to take a no-fault approach to the negative consequences of what is otherwise legal sex, particularly outside of the context of marriage. And one response, the one that you're exploring, the very thought-provoking response that you're exploring this evening, is this private law response. So using the law to empower individuals to protect themselves or define for themselves the rights and responsibilities arising from their sexual conduct. In Canada, I think, one of the differences is that in Canada, many, not all, and certainly not the emotional consequences arising from sexual interactions, but many of these parameters, whether we call them sexual values, moral sex, sexual ethics, many of them have actually been defined through public law. So either by the criminal law or through an equality-infused, equality-driven amendments to the legal regulation of relationship breakdown. So child support, spousal support, both in and outside the context of marriage. So for example, in Canada, the law in certain circumstances has developed an approach such that, otherwise legal consensual sex is deemed illegal or criminalized, right? Where that sex has potential harmful consequences. So I'm thinking of a couple of examples. The most obvious example being the criminalization of non-disclosure of HIV, HIV-positive status. So Canada has one of the highest rates of prosecution in the world of individuals who fail to disclose their HIV-positive status to their sexual partners. So individuals in Canada are quite frequently actually charged with either sexual assault or aggravated sexual assault for failing to disclose. Even in circumstances, and they're convicted even in circumstances where the virus is not ultimately transmitted. So it's really just the risk of. Another example where the law, the public law, has stepped in and criminalized sex that has the potential to cause harmful consequences is a Nova Scotia case from last year, a case called Hutchinson. You had an individual in the context of a monogamous, a short-term monogamous, non-domestic relationship that was nearing termination, and this individual surreptitiously sabotaged the condoms that the couple was using, so poked holes in the condoms. And then proceeded to use those condoms in an attempt to maintain the relationship by hoping to impregnate his girlfriend, which ultimately he was successful in doing. She ended the relationship. She discovered that she was pregnant. It came out that he'd sabotaged the condoms. She had an abortion. And ultimately, the Nova Scotia Court of Appeal last spring decided that Hutchinson should stand trial for aggravated sexual assault. So both of these examples, the non-disclosure of HIV status, HIV-positive status, and the sabotaging the condoms are, of course, examples of the criminal law, so public law, articulating what's outside the boundaries of acceptable sexual ethics in Canada. Now, these are at the outer limits of what the sexual boundaries are, obviously, but it's state-defined boundaries. In Canada, this is also true in the context of relationship recognition. So the laws regulating the dissolution of domestic relationships, so cohabitated relationships, marital or otherwise, and the laws establishing financial responsibility for children, whether they're marital, cohabitating, or otherwise. In Canada, in the last quarter century, we've had a massive, massive renovation of the laws recognizing and regulating conjugal relationships. And it's been in large measure driven by a charter equality-infused analysis. So again, public law, the Constitution in this context, rather than the criminal law, has driven the development of, you know, new approaches to, you know, for example, you know, or one example, the widespread recognition of common law spouses. But for the issue of property division, in Canada, we have, both common law and statute, we have widespread equality for common law spouses that equates those relationships to marital ones, both in terms of spousal support, access to benefits, visitation rights, pensions. And in fact, some people have hypothesized that, relatively speaking, the same-sex marriage fight in Canada was over so quickly because straight, you know, heterosexual common law couples had already really kind of chiseled away at the institution of marriage, such that, you know, the dispensation of rights and privileges and obligations didn't turn on the possession of a marriage certificate by the time same-sex couples came along and started fighting about same-sex marriage, right? So we'd already, to a large extent, in this narrow context, subverted the institution of marriage. By the time same-sex marriage legal battles were being fought, there was literally less at stake in terms of legal entitlements. Now, that would be, you know, both in, with respect to same-sex marriage and common law couples, we're talking about cohabitation. So that's not going to cover all of the, you know, important types of sexual relationships that you've identified. But again, all of this work was done, in a constitutional law framework, an entrenched rights framework. So sexual relationships giving rise to children, sexual relationships giving rise to financial dependency, and sexual relationships involving the commingling of property are, in the Canadian context, understood as rights issues, regardless of whether or not we're talking marriage, whether or not we're talking long-term, short-term. They are in the public domain. They are, in our legal culture, they are understood as greater than the sum of their individual parts or individual sexual actors. And changes to the law dealing with them have been done through a rights discourse and rather than the private law, so rather than a liberal sort of individual framework. And again, I think that's a reflection of the differing legal cultures and the role of the state in Canada and the U.S. In Canada, we have, for the most part, relied on the public law, like the criminal law, like the charter, more so than on contract law or tort law, to delineate the rights and obligations and privileges arising from sexual relationships. We seem to have a greater level of comfort with allowing the state into the bedroom, despite what Trudeau said in 1969. Now, one of the weaknesses with resorting to the public law in this way and relying on the public law to circumscribe the parameters of our sexual ethics is that, you know, the interpretation and the application of the criminal law or of constitutional rights tends to be a reflection of what Canadian society is thought to value. Right, so which means that public law approaches tend to protect and preserve and promote contemporary and to some extent dominant norms, so that unsurprisingly, certain sexual relationships, for example, commercial ones, sex work, or non-monogamous, non-commercial ones, have not received the same level of protection or entitlement because they aren't valued to the same degree. And so resorting to the public law isn't going to achieve the same results in that context. And so it seems to me that one of the things that's really promising about your project is that it might help us think through, you know, better approaches to protecting those sexual actors whose relationships in the Canadian context are not reflected in, you know, a very value-driven public law context. Given the litigation that the Vice President referenced in her introduction, ongoing in both Ontario and British Columbia right now, challenging the constitutionality of criminal code provisions regulating sex work or criminalizing the activities surrounding the exchange of sex for money, this is a particularly relevant question in Canada right now. And perhaps perhaps turning to principles of contract law might inform an approach which better accommodates the interests of these sexual actors. Certainly, you know, the Ontario decision, Justice Himmel's decision in Bedford last month, was, you know, came to the conclusion that the criminal law to date in Canada has done exactly the opposite with respect to the interests of sex workers in Canada. So that's one of the things that I find very interesting about your project. But that said, I do wonder, you know, I still wonder if we turn more to private law, do we risk, you know, furthering a kind of neoliberal approach, an approach which individualizes the responsibility for harmful sexual practices? And so I don't know the answer, but, you know, some of the questions that I thought about, is that better, or is it better to think of these issues as social issues, you know, community problems that we want public response to, issues which we require the state to take a position on? And so I don't know the answer, but I do ask the question, can private law, can individualized contracts promote social respect and support for diverse sexual relationships and conduct, or is it better to focus on state action? Is it better to amend criminal laws? Is it better to adopt and strengthen human rights codes protections? Is it better to recognize equality rights and liberty guarantees from a public law perspective with respect to sexual diversity? So is it better to use the public law to define parameters and then within these parameters leave individuals, you know, in a state of nature? Or does that, as you suggest, risk, you know, limiting people's options? And continuing to privilege some sexual relationships over others? So that was one, you know, one of the things that I had thought about. A second issue, and I'll just finish with this, that I'd love to hear more on, or that your project made me think more about, was, and again, this is particularly relevant in the Canadian context right now, it is something you touched briefly on in your presentation, and it pertains to the external limits on what can be contracted for. So this, of course, is one of the most difficult issues to grapple with when you're considering the relationship between law and sexuality, whether that be the criminal law, whether that be constitutionally entrenched rights, whether that be the private law. And like I said, it's a particularly relevant question in Canada right now because of a decision that our Supreme Court of Canada is currently deciding. So there's a case called J.A., which was heard last month, I think it was, in the Supreme Court, in which our High Court has been called upon to examine the balance between autonomy and equality in the sexuality context. So, which of course is ultimately the tension that's at stake when we suggest putting legal limits on what people can contract for in these sexual contracts. Again, Canadian legal culture has been, of course, much less reticent than American to interfere with freedom of contract. And so taking that idea and putting it in a Canadian context, the first thing we got to think about is, okay, well, what can't you contract for, right? And so in this JA case that's before the Supreme Court of Canada right now, the court's going to be struggling with this very issue. This case involved an individual who was convicted at trial of sexual assault for sexual acts performed on his, I'm not sure if it was a common law spouse or a civilly married wife, but sexual acts that he performed on his long-term partner while she was unconscious. The couple had on several occasions in the past engaged in consensual sadomasochistic breath play, so erotic asphyxiation type sexual conduct. And there was evidence at trial that she had consented in advance to sexual acts occurring while unconscious, and that this type of the particular sexual act in question, there was evidence to suggest that she had consented even to this particular sexual act. And so the issue that's before our court now, the issue that our court has to decide, is whether someone can consent in advance to sexual conduct occurring while unconscious. or whether this is a liberty interest that the state can legitimately deprive the individual of, right? Is this something that you can contract for, is the question I have. And so I wonder if they'd had a written contract outlining the terms of their, you know, engagement, you know, would this have changed the criminal law approach? And, you know, certainly would have implications concerning the type of evidence available to establish consent in this case. But I guess, you know, the broader question is what limits should a statutory contract regime place on the kind of sex that can be contracted for? And where do we turn to, more importantly, to figure out what those limits are? So again, and maybe I'm turning, you know, I'm circling back to where I started, but intuitively my sense is that we turn to the values articulated in the public law, the values of liberty and equality and autonomy. But I wonder, are there other sources of guidance? Perhaps, you know, work like Martha Nussbaum's, I'm not sure. But so this was one of the other questions that kind of arose for me when I was thinking through your very insightful ideas.
Anyway, those are great comments. And I have to say, I was a little bit thinking about BDSM relationships in the way that they are very often negotiated to some degree. And there is some degree, not always in all, some degree of informed consent particularly dominance and submission relationships. But in some relationships, there's less, you know, there's consent without sometimes fully knowing what someone is consenting to and how that would work. And just the whole idea of limits on contracts. I don't think one should be able to contract away. I mean, I don't think we should have slavery contracts, sexual slavery contracts, if people agree to that. And so obviously there, you know, would be values in the public law. But going back to the case you raised about the one case in public law where there can be someone can be held for not disclosing their HIV positive status, the question I had, I wonder, and this happens in the U.S. too, if you fail to find out your status because you don't get tested, are you held? Can you be held liable, or are you only held liable if you actually, take the trouble? If you're responsible and actually find out your status. And so one of the ways in which it seems to me the public law works is if often when there is a harm, have a way to address it. And what I'm thinking of these sexual contracts of doing is ways in which people can work out a relationship in order to somewhat prevent harm. So for example, and again, I don't know how enforceable they are, but it may be you want to be in a relationship. I often think of like serial monogamy. Let's say somebody to protect themselves against, you know, potentially getting an STI, wants their partner to get regularly tested, rather than deal with issues of, you know, knowing how, you know, whether their partner is having, sex outside their relationship, just simply ask for, that the person, they might, in a way, contract for either some degree of disclosure or some degree of testing in their relationship. Or there might be things that they ask for as a way of protecting themselves other than simply sexual exclusivity. And could you contract for that and ask for that in a relationship? Or could you, ask for something like sexual exclusivity for a certain limited period of time? But again, in those contracts, when they're breached, then of course the damage, one can only ask for, right, I guess, some kind of damage award as opposed to any kind of criminal prosecution. But it does, I think we have to distinguish a case where criminal prosecution for harming somebody seems appropriate and civil damage awards might be appropriate for breach of contract. And so, for example, in the U.S., some have proposed, even in cases of date rape, where you have all kinds of joint responsibility, if let's say, like we often have in college situation, where both parties are intoxicated and using drugs, but predatory sex takes place, but the the assail both are fairly inebriated. It's very hard to get sometimes a criminal prosecution and conviction in those cases. but you might be able to get some kind of, you know, bring it, you know, some kind of civil damage award. And it may be that criminal prosecution is just too, you know, too much, not the right, you know, tool to use in that kind of context. It certainly might be the right tool to use when you have certain other cases of predatory sex, but there might be cases where you have, you know, predatory sex where there's joint responsibility or some amount of joint responsibility, although one party may be more responsible than the other. So that may be one way to distinguish when we want to use private law versus public law. So anyway, with that, I'll stop with these very interesting and perceptive comments.
All right, so now we're going to open things up for questions.
Okay, I have some comments, several. I think that the idea of a contract is interesting. It's interesting because, to me, more it's interesting because it's an avenue to talk about sex responsibility in a different way. But in Canada, like, there's nothing stopping us from doing that without having a format.
Right.
You can just take your sexual partner to a lawyer and draft something up, and it's a legal document. And I'm very pessimistic about law being a tool for women, especially because how classed it is. So I've done 10 years work in a transition house and a rape crisis center, which I want to get to in a second. But in order for any legal contract, including criminal law, but especially civil law, women are not successful. Women don't even get through the doors. And so making a legal contract seems to me only would serve, without a reform to legal aid, would only serve women who already have a means, and those women who already have a means just need a strategy. They don't need a new contract. But I like the idea of talking about sex and talking about autonomy and talking about responsibility. Where I deviate from you, and in part why I dragged myself here, was, no offense, but you know, it's a school night and it's cold outside, but is that the context of violence against women is just too great to ignore in marriage, in prostitution, everywhere. From my work in the transition house, to me, in some ways, this is the crudest I can get about marriage and prostitution. Marriage was the prostitute you rent for a long period, and the prostitute was the wife you rent for a short period. And in both of those cases, those two women are polarized to detest each other, and in fact, they have so much in common. And my version of a socially responsible, sexually free society does not need any law governing us. Like, I'll give you an analogy. I was on a bike tour, and my girlfriend and I, we found a wallet and with 50 bucks, actually had more than 50 bucks in it. And so we debated on the highway. We're on a bike tour. We're like, should we try to find who this person's wallet is and return the money or not? So, you know, we considered it. And then we found the person. They met us on the highway. It was kind of an interesting event. But I was wondering, why was I having such a hard time trying to answer that question? If it was my wallet, I'd want it returned. But we returned the wallet because we wanted to be in the type of society that's what you did. We didn't want there to be a government insane us, this is the right thing to do. We wanted to be the ones who control our society. And I think in terms of sexuality, that's the same. My objection about the prostitution, I think, is swept too quickly in the larger conversation about a sexual contract. Because as far as I understand, women do not have sexual autonomy now, and even in relationships where women are having orgasm, you still don't have sexual equality and sexual autonomy.
Okay, now time for the response. Thanks.
Thank you for those. That's a very interesting comment. I mean, you're right that right now people could go to an attorney and draw up some kind of agreement that would have some kind of legal status. It's not always clear that the courts might honor the contract. So, for example, with surrogacy contracts in the U.S., they're not, people can draw them up. But if the surrogate mother doesn't want to give her child over to the biological father, it's not always the case that even though they might have a legal agreement, it will be recognized. And so if ever my idea were ever institutionalized or wherever there has been like a practice like Mutah, it is a kind of, you know, there is a kind of, I guess you might say, an understanding in advance that this kind of contract would be legally honored. So that would be one advantage I think it would have over just going to an attorney and just simply individuals drawing up some kind of agreement. The other thing, as you point out, it's very expensive to hire attorneys to work out your, you know, whatever property division and, you know, whatever kind of, whatever parts of your relationship you want to formalize. And so the idea I was thinking is that this would make it actually more democratic and available to all because it would just, there would just be a kind of standardized contract that people could, you know, modify to fit their circumstances, but the cost of registering it wouldn't be very much. And so this would make it available to people without their having to pay, you know, the significant fees that we usually pay, at least in the US, to an attorney. But the idea, yeah, no, it's true that a contract doesn't protect you in all kinds of ways. Sometimes it's really just a piece of paper. But it is a public statement, and it's a public statement to others that you want this part of your relationship acknowledged and respected. So if you want, let's say, you're in a relation sexually intimate with someone, and you want them to be able to visit you if you're ever hospitalized, and, you know, often hospitals will only let close family members visit, but you want your non-marital lover to be able to visit you, you could specify that in a kind of contract, and hopefully the hospital and others would honor it, and that there would be, you know, some understanding that these contracts and the terms of them, to some degree in public law, would have to determine the degree to which they, you know, we could specify and what we could formalize. But once people had done it, it really puts the burden on others to then respect those arrangements, whether they be arrangements about property issues, visitation rights, inheritance rights, what to do in custody arrangements, where there are children involved, and so on. But, you know, I mean, I think, you know, unfortunately, I think people outside of those formalized arrangements leave themselves open to being, to have, you know, sometimes be wronged or harmed, and then in ways that they have very little, you know, redress. And that's going to happen even when you have a contract. But I think the idea of the contract is you could at least specify in advance, you know, what the terms were, and have to some degree those terms enforced and have others respect them. And like you said, it would, by the very fact that there would be this availability of such a contract, what I would hope is that it would encourage people to think about, you know, how to protect the interests of their sexual partners, how to protect their well-being. And it would, in the way that I think actually BDSM relationships do, they would encourage a kind of openness and discussion about the expectations and responsibilities as well as entitlements and privileges in these relationships. Now again, I don't think all relationships would, you know, there are people who have fairly casual relationships, have very short-term one-night stand relationships. I don't think all sexual relationships that people would want to formalize, you know, the arrangements, but it should just be available to people who want something, you know, want some sort of, you know, social recognition and for certain terms of their relationship, but they don't want to go as far as marriage in order to get that. And then there are people, I also think marriage should be open to more people. I have, you know, I think, you know, for people who want marriage, that should be there, and that I don't think, I find it interesting that, yeah, as you said, in the Canadian context, there was less to fight over. In the U.S., of course, the status of wives in marriage has changed quite a lot, so that there aren't really different duties based on the sex of who's in a marriage. And that's why it really should make no difference whether two people in a marriage are, you know, whatever, you know, sex they are. But there's still a lot of benefits you get in being married. There's still a lot of financial and social and other benefits that are attached to marriage, and I guess I want to pull some of those away from this, you know, the marital status, and make those benefits available to sexual couples or, you know, groups, whatever, however they're defined.
So given that there's pre-existing inequality in sexual relationships, which I think has already been touched on and you've identified, how is the contract negotiation process not just going to be a way to legalize that inequality? And the second part of my question is, so what happens if you break it? Are you incarcerated or fined? And what if incarceration means you can't get a job after? And what if being fined means you're going to go into collections?
Right. Well, I don't envision that it would be, and most of the time, breach of legal contract, I guess it can involve, you know, penalties that are fairly severe, but most of the time it would not involve, it's not a criminal, you're not violating the criminal law, so presumably you wouldn't have a criminal record that follows you. It would be simply like, you know, being a divorced person. If you had entered a contract and you, at some point, you ended that contract, or you know, it was either unilaterally or bilaterally. But the other issue you raise, I think, is interesting, is how would people negotiate it? And obviously people negotiate from a position of power, and if you leave too much freedom for people to, you know, make the terms very individualized, does that mean the person who's in a greater position of power is going to be able to get a contract that, you know, is uneven and out of which they get greater benefits than the other? And so again, that's why I think we have to come up with something like a standard contract, and obviously with some list of potential entitlements and responsibilities, but you know, we might want to limit what they are and make sure the terms of them were equitable, so that people couldn't, you know, again, agree to slave contracts. People enter, of course, marriage with different from different positions of power, and that could, of course, structure the reality of the marriage. Right, when women enter and they become economically dependent on their husbands, there's a power dynamic in the relationship, even if they have formal equality under the marriage, and that could certainly happen with these as well. And so that issue of unequal power probably has to be addressed in other ways. I don't think my proposal probably addresses that enough, right? The issue of it doesn't address the issue of unequal power, and therefore, the extent to which, when that exists, one party might be exploited by the other. We may have to think of other arrangements so that that doesn't happen. And that is, you know, part of the way we do that is to empower people who enter, whether they enter an employment contract or they enter a marriage contract or they enter a sexual contract, we have to make sure that they have certain general rights as citizens and also access to certain opportunities like education, so that they are empowered in those relationships and that they have a kind of economic equality as well, which is important to empowering people.
Fascinating discussion. I'd just like to amplify the comments in the discussion by reference to Alan Young's recent paper called "The State Is Still in the Bedrooms of the Nation." I was going to actually comment on something before Ardith just raised it and sort of say, well, I wonder whether the courts would be clogged with breach of contract cases, or maybe it would go to small claims courts. The question I really wanted to ask, though, was, and maybe I didn't understand you correctly, did you envisage that the sexual contract, which of course, as you said, would be voluntary, would also apply in transactional sex? For instance, it is protected under New Zealand law since 2003, although unilaterally, and in a recent case, a decision in the Cassation Court in Italy, it was actually decided that breach of contract was a criminal law offence, namely statutory rape. but it would certainly provide much more protection for sex workers if they were had contracts that could be recognized in law, whether it be civil or criminal.
Right. And I was envisioning it to apply to sex work situations. And I was thinking of it in terms of often sex workers I know who have long-term relationships sometimes with clients, and they might want to simply formalize the economic arrangements as well as other arrangements that they might, you know, want to have formalize other aspects of their relationship, inheritance. I mean, it wouldn't be surprising to me that a client of a sex worker might want to, if he were to pass on, might want to leave some of his property, not just to a legal wife or a mistress, but also maybe, you know, a long-term, you know, prostitute or sex worker that he was, you know, involved with. So I do envision it, and I also envision, think about it, that with this kind of contract, you know, and it, you know, in cases where there's a kind of, you know, as I mentioned, a one-directional exchange of money, and by formalizing that as the, you know, as one of the dimensions of the relationship, and there may be other dimensions to the relationship, it also brings that out into the open, but it also, you know, in a way, by formalizing it, those who do that are demanding a certain kind of public respect for that aspect of their relationship. You know, and there are relationships that are economically unequal, where in a marriage, right, where one party, you know, brings in all the income and the other person provides all the domestic services, and where there might be some understanding about how, you know, about the sexual relationship they have in those terms. So that goes on often informally in a marriage, even when it's not formalized as part of a marriage. And so in these kind of relationships where it is part of the agreement in a sex work contract, that could be formalized in advance. And I do think it would give greater respectability to certain forms of sex work.
Good. Thank you.
I think we have another question.
Hi. Thanks for your talk. I really like your approach to the sex contract as a way of protecting the rights and interests of sex workers. But as you were talking through the question period, I had a question that was raised in your talk and also raised by your discussant that I'm still trying to answer, which is, what is the difference between marriage and the sex contract for you? Because when I listened to you in the discussion period, it seems like the sex contract can do a lot of the work of a marriage contract, securing certain rights and privileges that would be awarded through marriage, et cetera, but in the private law context. And so when your discussant was raising this difference between public law and private law and saying that in Canada, public law is protecting equality, liberties, autonomy, and this is not, and these are not necessarily protected through private contract law or just private law, I guess. So then I wonder, on the one hand, it seems like your idea of the sex contract is supposed to secure many of the rights and privileges of the marriage contract. How are they different? And on the other hand, it seems like you want the private contract to do a lot of the work of what we see happening in public law, and is that something which is possible? I guess, I mean, maybe it is, I just don't know, but I want to know what you think.
Right, thank you. Yeah, no, in some ways I envision the sex contracts to be a lot like marriage contracts, in that, you know, they would define a set of rights and responsibilities. I mean, I suppose the difference is, you know, legal marriage is a pretty, you know, is a certain set of rights and responsibilities, and it's a kind of one-size-fits-all deal. And it's primarily intended for people who want long-term, I mean, the way it is in, I would assume in Canada, but in the U.S., it's intended for people who want an indefinite, you know, a relationship of indefinite term. I mean, the ideal is to last until you die, but with now with the availability of divorce and no-fault divorce, the understanding is it's just an indefinite, there's no expiration date on it. And so it's intended for people who want that kind of relationship, as well as who, you know, who at least have the option of co-parenting and therefore want, you know, legal parental recognition for the offspring of that, of their marriage. even if they're not the biological parents, right? In some cases, the father, right, the husband in the relationship can be the legal father, or is presumed to be the legal father of his wife's children, even if he's not the biological father. But what I want to argue is that doesn't always work for people who don't want to either cohabitate or have a relationship of that term, or who might not be interested in having children, or they might have children, but they might have them, one person adopts and the other person isn't going to be the legal father. I mean, it will allow for different kinds of relationships. There's one case I was thinking of when I was writing this, and there was a case in the US, and I've been trying to find this, where it involved a married couple who split up. The wife had a temporary relationship with, you know, another man, for several months. She conceived they conceived a child together. Somehow she left him, went back to her husband, and then had the child, and her lover sued for paternity and lost and got no paternity visitation or custody rights at all. And the reasoning of the judge was, if any kind of custody or visitation or recognition of paternity was given to her, essentially what I guess the judge considered her adulterous partner, because she was still legally married when she had this relationship, although she was alienated from her husband at the time, that it would threaten the marriage. So the ideal of holding the marriage together was essentially given a greater priority than the parental rights of this guy that she had this relationship with. And it's always seemed to me to be unfair to this man who had this relationship with this woman, conceived a child together, and should have been able to somehow share and have some recognition of you know, and even if it might, of course, been destabilizing, it might have been that the married couple wanted to put this affair in their past, but I'm not sure that's fair, you know, to the, you know, in this case, to the man. So I was thinking, you know, this would be a sort of case where someone, if they think they might be in a relationship that could eventually result in children, maybe, you know, if they had formalized the understanding, the woman and her non-married partner with whom she had a biological child, this could have given greater protection to this man. So that he, now, of course, people don't always think in advance, and of course, people aren't necessarily, when they're engaged in non-marital sex or extramarital sex, don't always think about, oh, this could result in a child, and I'm going to want some, you know, there are certain rights I'm going to want with respect to that child. But the idea was that if we had an understanding that people could have these kind of non-marital sexual relationships, and they entailed certain rights and responsibilities, that this situation where this guy got nothing at all might have been turned out differently. And so that's one way. It's different than marriage because it recognizes that people are going to often have different kinds of families. Families that might involve no children, or families that involve one person having children that the other person doesn't have, you know, the right of sort of legal fatherhood or motherhood over. It's going to recognize that these people can have sexual relationships and not cohabitate. They might not commingle their property. And so it would allow for formalizing those kinds of sexual relations. Also, the contract doesn't require sexual exclusivity. In marriage, at least in the U.S., I don't know how it is in Canada, you can only marry one person at a time. If you marry someone else, it's bigamy. You have a current legal case about the
British Columbia.
Right. So but the idea of sexual contracts is that I think it's an open question, but I would argue that people should be allowed to have more than one of these at a time. Again, I think there ought to be some kind of disclosure, and it seems to me respect for the autonomy of anyone who would enter such a contract would require that a person entering would have to disclose that they had other such contracts with other people. But this would allow for that, for people to have more than one. What if there should be an upper limit on the number? I don't know. You know, there have been in the history of different societies, you know, communities where you had communal marriage that involved dozens of people, and, you know, various experiments with that. And so, I mean, I think those are historically interesting cases, and if people want to try those kind of social experiments, they should be free to do so.
Okay, well, I'm looking at the clock and it's getting late, so, and we're not finished with the evening. We have another element to it, so I'm going to pass things over to Elizabeth and thank everybody for their questions.
Thank you. This is a great question.
I just want to actually introduce, that was Marnina Gonick, who's our Canadian research chair here in gender at Mount St. Vincent. And this ends the formal part, and I think like any really good talk, both of you have raised more questions than you've answered. So I'd like to invite all of you to come next door, just through here, to Seton 404 for a reception where we can continue the discussion. Thank you very much to both our speakers for wonderful presentations. I'd also like to thank CCEPA, Chris Stover, Sheila Brown, who couldn't be here tonight, and the organizing committee here, Meredith Ralston, Marnina Gonick, Artith Weinick is there, and please join us. Chris asked me to remind you to fill out your evaluations. You can just leave them here on the way out. And please come in January to continue the debate and the discussion. January the 20th will be Melissa Dittmore talking about sex work and human rights. Thank you much, very much, everyone.
Good evening.